is happening is Stuart's men can now be killed and wounded at a much longer distance than any themselves can kill or wound Union soldiers. And so consequently, the amount of casualties and damage to the enemy's infrastructure that you can inflict is greatly impaired with the Union cavalry right now. And they know this and are using this to their advantage against Stuart. That's a good point that you bring up, good insightful point. But of course, the artillery is so effectively handled here, and it's starting to outgun the Confederate horse artillery, which is being silenced by it, and kind of battery fire. So the Union horse artillery starts to play a much more dominant role against the Confederate cavalry here. And here you see a charge by the Confederates trying to knock down some of the Union horse artillery. From safety, the more men are killed by pistols now than by the sabers. Just during Stuart, we lose about 150 men here during the 3-hour battle, whereas, after Grant lost about 150 men here during the battle, Stuart's losses are 3/4 that many. 350 men are killed and wounded by the Confederates. Technology and firepower, both of the horse artillery and the carbine, is so much more effective against Stuart's men. Again, yes, yes, well, those aren't drawn sabers, ladies and gentlemen. That is the even in today's United States Army, when you see someone that belongs to the armor branch of today's Army, you see the cross sabers with the tank insignia in the center of the cross sabers, so we still maintain the remembrance of our tradition and heritage in today's modern army.
Right here.
And now the Confederate forces seem to be falling back. After that, the Union forces coming back here near our center of the audience. And again,
as quick as possible, because what you want to do, Craig, is again, it's very important for the infrastructure of the company and the regiment to see what NCOs and officers are killed, wounded, or dehorsed. The non-commissioned officers and the junior line officers in the company would maintain the semblance of order in the company, and therefore would enable the company to proceed in an orderly fashion in the battle. Now that sounds contradictory, but you've got to maintain control over your company and your regiment's enforcement. Otherwise, you've got nothing more than a Hollywood zoo, whether it's in 1863 or 1988. So it's critically important, the role of the junior officers in the company and the role of the non-commissioned officers. They maintain discipline, they maintain unit formation, and unit integrity. The integrity of the units is critical here. And you can tell what units are well-disciplined and veteran units by how they maintain their integrity, whether it's in a column charge or hand-to-hand combat, as you've just seen.
Margaret, you have the chain of command very clearly defined. The functions passed down. As one man who might have been in charge falls, the man junior to him immediately moves up and is immediately accepted and has basically probably been preparing to be able to fill this role if as when necessary.
Exactly, exactly. And that's what we do in today's Army also. We try to make sure that every soldier can perform at least at the next higher rank in order for him to take over from his superiors, be they enlisted or officer, during actual combat or training scenarios, because people are injured in training, and you've seen some folks injured out here yesterday and today, and this does occur, unfortunately, in training exercises. But it's critically important, not only for unit integrity, but to develop the leadership quality of each individual soldier, both in 1863 and in 1988, to give them that initiative, that sense of belonging, that sense of being able to go out there and do their duty to their utmost capability.
So immediately after the engagement, particularly we see it here with these cavalry forces, they reform and regroup, decide to discover who is missing, who must fill in,
and get themselves organized for the next
initiative as much as possible in mounted warfare, just like an armor warfare of George Patton, whom I'm going to talk about tomorrow during Pickett's Charge, because his great uncle served in Pickett's Charge, as did a number of his other great uncles and grandfathers in the Confederate Army. Everything is initiative, 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 attack, 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 because you want to keep the enemy.
Were there actual periods of order during the original battle, or did the confusion that marked much of the 3 days at Gettysburg pervade this cavalry action as well?
Confusion will mark cavalry when they're actually fighting hand-to-hand or going into or coming out of direct combat. But cavalry has to pull back. All the bridles and girths on the horses have to be tightened and pulled to make sure that horsemen won't slip off because their saddles are going on them. And they have to check the stirrups, they have to check the leather to make sure it's not going to break on them in combat. And they lose. Remember the old saying, for the want of the nail, the shoe was lost, for the want of the shoe, the horse was lost, for the want of the horse, the king was lost, for the want of the king, the battle was lost, for the want of the battle, the kingdom was lost. It's mounted cavalry who are covering fire support now for the mounted cavalry that have pulled back to regroup. Now, ladies and gentlemen, in the far distance, you see and hear the Union horse artillery. One reason they are so effective is not because they're veterans and they're dedicated professional soldiers after 2 years of warfare, but also remember this: the Union horse artillery is tremendously well drilled, trained, and supplied, because there is a genius running the artillery of the Army of the Potomac by the name of Henry. We're going to hear more about General Hunt tomorrow during Pickett's Charge. But Hunt has totally reorganized the artillery of the Army of the Potomac in such a way as to make sure that each man and each weapon is doing its utmost at all times, and that they are fully supplied. The Confederates run out of ammunition in many cases here for their artillery and for their carbines due to ineffective resupply, due to poor logistics. Whereas the Union has a superior logistical system because of Henry Hunt, because of Montgomery C. Meigs with the Quartermaster Depot in Washington. Because of these two combined factors, the Union artillery is so well supplied, it can continue to throw shells at the Confederate cavalry and horse artillery ad infinitum, greatly demoralizing them and causing many casualties. As I mentioned a second ago, Stuart would lose 3 men for every 1 Union cavalryman lost out here today.
And as we mentioned, I believe, in yesterday's broadcast, the South